Hello, statisticians. Mr. Young Saver here from Skew the Scripts. Today, we're going to analyze whether employers discriminate in their hiring based on race. And we're going to do so by using a two-sample confidence interval using data from one of the most clever studies I've ever seen that investigates this very issue. Let's skew it. Today's lesson is on the confidence interval for two proportions. This is lesson 7.7 in our course sequence. In the United States, we've seen a persistent gap in the wages between white and black people over time. Specifically, if you look at the difference between white men and black men in their annual median earnings, there's an $18,000 gap. In 10 years, that's a $180,000 gap. In 20 years, that's a $360,000 gap. In 45 years, the length of time that people usually work from starting to retirement, that's about over $800,000. And those differences are consequential. That could be the difference between being able to afford owning your own home, paying for your kids' college, getting good healthcare. So people wonder what causes these racial gaps. Some people argue that it's social factors. There's inequity in schools that limit access to an education that will get you a good job. There is differences in social networks. People might not know people who are high up in certain industries that would then be able to give them preference in the hiring process. There might be differences in how people choose to pursue the career and then therefore the amount of money they could gain from their career choice. There's also people who say there's still direct discrimination in the hiring process. Managers discriminate in who they hire. So these are all confounding factors. It's hard to parse out if one of these is the cause, a combination of these is the cause, or none of these is the real cause of where these gaps come from. But researchers wanted to test if direct hiring discrimination was still an important factor in labor markets. So these two brilliant economists decided to run an experiment, because the way you control for confounding factors is you run an actual experiment. And their experiment's design was nothing short of brilliant. Now this lesson is going to present a simplified version of their study design. However, the data in this lesson is identical to the data they found in their study. If you want to look up the full study, the citation is right here. What they did was they created a bunch of identical copies of resumes. And the only thing they changed on these resumes was the name. They use commonly white names and commonly black names. And the way they found these names was they went into Massachusetts birth certificate records and they found the names that are most exclusively used by both racial groups. And they sent these resumes based on job ads in Boston and Chicago newspapers. They sent it to a wide swath of jobs in the following industries: sales, administrative support, clerical services, and customer services. And to a large range of positions, from what they say in their paper, this is the language they use, cashier work at retail establishments and clerical work in the mailroom, to office and sales management positions. In total, they found 4,890 employers. And they randomly assigned them to get either a resume that had a commonly white name on it or a commonly black name on it. So they evenly split those between the two groups. And they measured which group got more callbacks from these potential employers, a higher rate of callbacks from the resumes. So today's key analysis is, do hiring managers discriminate in callbacks based on race, according to the study? If you want to follow along using our guided notes, you can print it up at this URL on our website. So first, let's talk about one versus two sample inference. We're going to go straight into the results from the paper. Here are the results they got in terms of callbacks between these two resume groups. So you have treatment one, treatment two in this experiment, the commonly white names, the commonly black names in the resumes. And they had identical sample sizes, and they found the proportion of callbacks for each group. When you do that calculation, you found that the white group got a higher proportion of callbacks than the black group. So these are our two sample proportions, a portion of commonly white names that got a callback, a portion of commonly black names on these resumes that got a callback. And if there's hiring discrimination, you would expect that the proportion who got callbacks was higher for the white group than for the black group. And that's what we found in our sample size, in our sample portions. But what we really need to test is, are these proportions different enough to show discrimination? Or could this difference have been due to chance alone in the random assignment process? Could it have been randomly assigned that the names with commonly black name resumes on them got randomly assigned by chance to the more difficult employers, and therefore that's where this is coming from? Or is there enough evidence to show that that's not plausible? So we have one sample situation we talked about before where you compare a statistic in one population against a claim of that population. Here's an example of where we did that earlier in the course. This is a two sample situation where you're measuring the same statistic, but in two different populations, or in this case, the experiment, two different treatments, and see if those are significantly different. So let's talk about how we create a confidence interval in this two sample situation. So normally you don't need to set hypotheses up to construct a confidence interval. This case is no different, but I want to set it up, the hypotheses, just as a reference point for us going forward. So if I were to do a hypothesis, these would be my hypotheses. The null hypothesis, the default one, is that there's no discrimination, so the callback rates are identical among all people who apply to jobs like the ones in this study. Those are the true proportion values. The alternative is that the white group gets a higher rate of callbacks because there is discrimination. So one way to mathematically set up these hypotheses to be a little bit more convenient is do a bit of subtraction, subtract the P2 from both sides, and you get P1 minus P2 equals zero in the null hypothesis group. The reason for that is if those are equal, then when you subtract them, you should get zero. That's just a little bit more mathematically convenient for us to use. Same thing on the other side. If you subtract, you should get a number greater than zero because the callback rate should be higher among the white, commonly white negative group. And this is how we're going to frame these hypotheses because it's more mathematically convenient for us. So now let's make an interval. Here's our null hypothesis. When you subtract those proportions, you get zero. The actual proportions we saw in our sample data was this. If you subtract them, you get 0.034. There's a 3.4% difference in callback rates. So what kind of confidence interval can we make around that? And is our null hypothesis included in that interval? Well, we can get the sampling distribution of all the results that could have happened by chance variation in the random assignment, but didn't. And then that creates the sampling distribution we see here. It's really called randomization distribution, but I'm using the sampling distribution terminology. Now we know that to get 95% confidence, we need to get 1.96 standard deviations out. That gets 95% if this is a normal curve. So how far exactly is 1.96 standard deviations? Well, under certain conditions, we know that this sampling distribution goes according to this formula. And note, I use sigma here, but it should really be standard error, but I'm just gonna use that notation for simplicity. I'm gonna have an optional video that we'll eventually make, and in the description, there'll be a link to it where you can see how I derived this. So the key information to know here is that we're centered at the sample proportion difference that we got. And the spread is a combo of P1 and P2. And note that we're still dividing by the sample size. So there's a lower spread, the higher sample size you get, as with earlier sampling distributions we derived. We plug in what we know, and this is the normal curve we get. We're centered at 0.034, the difference between those proportions, with a standard deviation, a typical distance from those proportions of 0.0079. So we get 1.96 times that standard deviation out on both sides, really it's standard errors, but we're gonna say standard deviation for now. And we get plus 0.0155 minus 0.0155, we get this confidence interval. So that's our confidence interval, which means that we are 95% confident the interval from 1.85% to 4.95% captures the true difference in proportion of callbacks for resumes with commonly white versus black names among jobs similar to the ones used in this study. Note, this is key, zero is outside of our interval. That means that the value at which these proportions are equal is not plausible. Therefore, we have convincing evidence that commonly white name resumes received a higher callback since our entire interval is positive values, meaning the difference in those proportions of callbacks is positive. So let's derive the formula that we just did for the confidence interval. In a confidence interval, it's always statistic plus or minus some margin of error. For one sample interval, that was p hat plus or minus 1.96 standard errors out, which was, this was our standard error. In this case, for a 95% interval, we use 1.96. For a two sample interval formula, we have this much more complicated standard error, which you can see is kind of some function of the single one. And again, I'll have a video driving that. Note, it's very easy to make a mistake when plugging into this formula. So we're gonna use mostly our calculator for calculating this. And I'll show you how to do that when we get to the four step process. In general, if you want to make a C percent confidence interval, not be struck with 95%, all you got to do is adjust that critical value to be more or less standard errors out from your center statistic value. So now let's go through the four-step process for doing this confidence interval. Again, the four-step process is just a way to organize your work when you're asked to do inference on FRQs. So when you see construct and interpret 95% confidence interval, you know you should do the four steps. First, state the parameter you're estimating the confidence level. We are constructing a 95% confidence interval for the difference between those proportions. We're interested, are they significantly different? So that's how we're gonna state that there. Plan, we need to name the inference method and check conditions. We're gonna do a two samples interval. Note that it's two samples here because we have two different treatments for P1 minus P2 if all conditions are met. Why do we have to check conditions? Well, remember, we're assuming that the sampling distribution is going according to this normal curve with this calculation. So if those conditions aren't met, we can't use this and our interval becomes meaningless. And the Conditions correspond to what we've seen before. The random condition makes sure that you have an unbiased center. The 10% condition makes sure that your spread calculation goes according to the formula. The large counts condition makes sure that your sampling distribution is approximately normal in shape. So let's check those conditions. Was this random? Well, yes. Employers were randomly assigned, not sampled, but assigned because it's an experiment, either a commonly white or commonly black name resume to receive. Now note, if we're randomly sampling, we need to verify the data come from two independent random samples. If we have two samples, they need to be independent. But in this case, since we're doing an experiment, we don't need to verify that. 10%. In this case, both population samples would need to be less than 10% of the populations they're being sampled from. Now, we only have to do this when we're sampling. We're not sampling in this case, we're doing an experiment, so we actually don't need to check the 10% condition, but otherwise we would need to check both. And then large counts. So in this case, large counts now gets kind of multiplied by two because we have two samples that we're checking large counts for, but we gotta do both. So we plug in what we know for both, and we see that in each case, all four calculations come out to be greater than or equal to 10, so we're good to go, all conditions are met. Now we're gonna perform the calculations using our calculator. This is gonna be a lot easier than plugging in. You can take a pause and look at the steps here, but I'm gonna go through it right now using my on-screen calculator. So to find this, you need to go stat, tests, and find the two prop Z interval, which is option B right here. I've preloaded it with our stuff. We had 246 callbacks out of 2445 commonly white resumes sent out. 164 callbacks among 2445 resumes with commonly black names on them. And then we're doing a 95% interval, 0.95. Do calculate, we get the interval we got before, 0.018 to 0.049. So once we get that, we should report the confidence interval we got along with the calculator commands we use with everything labeled properly. And then we're gonna do our conclusion, interpret the interval. We did this interpretation before, 95% confident, ... So now, let's use our interval to draw a conclusion. Well, as we said before, the null hypothesis value, zero, is outside the interval. It's not plausible these proportions are equal. So yes, there is a convincing evidence of a difference in callback rates between these two groups. Now let's get into our discussion. So there's a difference between statistically significant and practically significant. A statistically significant difference means the difference is too large to arise by chance alone in the sampling process or in the random assignment process. A practically important difference is different. The difference is large enough to have real consequences in the world. Confidence intervals on hypothesis tests have margins of error that tell us if something is statistically significant in a difference. But we have to use descriptive statistics and our own experiences of what is true in the world to know if a difference is practically important. So here's my discussion question for you. Using this data, using the confidence interval, using this, we found the difference between callback rates was statistically significant, but is it practically important? Look at the data, the callback rates, and the final confidence interval. Do you think the margin of difference between the black and white callback rates is practically important? Explain your reasoning. That's it for today's statisticians. Have a good day.